Hey everybody, my name is Jason Hughes, and today what I'm going to go through is Arrow Flight SQL and really how it enables universal ODBC and JDBC drivers. So what we'll go through in the talk is we'll first start off with why do we need new ODBC and JDBC drivers? Right? Like why do anything? And then really as the solution to the problems that we'll go through there, we'll introduce Arrow Flight. We'll talk about the benefits of Arrow Flight and then really talk about really why that Arrow Flight alone isn't enough. It doesn't address all of the use cases and the abilities that ODBC and JDBC do. So then we'll really introduce Arrow Flight SQL as the thing that does, right? Or gets closer to that ODBC and JDBC world of the benefits that it provides. But then we'll actually take it one step further and really talk about how actually that on its own isn't enough for today's adoption of Arrow Flight, really ODBC and JDBC. And then we'll kind of talk about really why these ODBC and JDBC drivers that are based on Arrow Flight SQL, why they're important and what's the value of them. So after that, we really do a comparison. We'll compare, traditional ODBC, JDBC with Arrow Flight SQL, ODBC, JDBC, and look at kind of the differences there. And then we'll wrap it up with some considerations, right? Of, do I use this all the time? Or, what are the trade-offs, right? When wouldn't I? So let's jump in. So really, why don't ODBC and JDBC fit in today's analytics world? So if we look at it, really kind of going back in history, is that ODBC, the first release was 1992, JDBC first release in 1997. And really in that world, most of the, many client to many database requirements were row-based. It was either OLTP workloads, or it was certainly some OLAP workloads as well, but most of those weren't returning a lot of data to the client because the client wasn't doing a lot of logic on that stuff, right? It was just, yep, database, you do the heavy crunching, return me a small result set, and then I'll go display that or, perhaps work with the data smaller as well, right? So it was beneficial, right? It certainly provided a lot of abilities, but one of the keys is that it really prevented this, many-to-many client-to-database APIs where you have every client has their own API and every database has their own API, right? So to do anything, you end up with this many-to-many proliferation. But because it really only standardized the client side, what you ended up with was the world that we live in now, which is, this one-to-many where you have this ODBC, JDBC API to the actual database protocols themselves, right? So if you ever, try to connect to a data source on Tableau, you see just that, that page of all of those different systems, right? And that's the world that's been. We've kind of accepted that. But, it could be better. So let's take a look at today. Right. And really today is that you kind of have two big pieces here. One is that it's really the big data world, right? The three V's, but really one of the keys for this conversation is that the volume, right? The amount of data that people are working with is grown just gigantic, right? But also that the clients, it's not just the database doing the computation anymore. Now you also have clients that are doing some heavy computation or at least computation on big data, right? On large amounts of data. So what you end up with is that what we learned a good amount of time ago is that if you're dealing with large amounts of data in OLAP workloads, storing your data in a columnar format is generally going to give you a lot of benefits. So databases generally started adopting that, and clients generally started adopting that as well, certainly a lot of them. But you can either, so then if you want to connect to a database, you can connect direct point to point using that database's custom API, right? But then we're back into the same problem as before. Or you can use ODBC and JDBC, which will help the standardization. But then basically what you end up with is that the data's column there on the right, data's column there on the source, on the destination as well. But when you transfer it over the network, it actually is row-based, right? So you end up with this bottleneck of having to convert it from columnar to row and then transfer in row, convert it back from row to columnar. It should take a very long time, especially if the data sizes grow, right? So let's take a step back. Let's kind of look at the situation and see if we can come up with a better solution, right? So if you look at today's world where we have the data stored in columnar format, it's really processed in the database in columnar format, and the client's also columnar. Well, can't we just transfer it over the network in columnar format and leverage the benefits of columnar? Like for instance, really being able to compress the data and do run-length encoding and all sorts of different abilities, where you can actually maximize the amount of logical data that you transfer in a fewer amount of bytes, right? Because now the network can be your bottleneck. So the answer is yes, And really the way that we can do this is with Arrow Flight, right? And that's really where Arrow Flight comes in, of providing that, you know, straight, like don't even convert it, right? Just it's an arrow on the source, or at least close to arrow in columnar format, convert that to arrow. And then you can transfer that over to the client, which also is going to speak arrow or something very similar, depending on the client. And then so you can provide these benefits, right? You can really improve your performance for the network transfer. So that all sounds great, right? Like, aren't we done now? And the answer is not exactly. For, you know, depending for really specific like workloads, really around SQL, right? So if we take a look at, you know, why Arrow Flight isn't enough for all workloads, and specifically here, we'll talk about, you know, SQL and OLAP workloads, is that the client sends an arbitrary byte stream, right? And the server interprets that arbitrary byte stream and then sends a result back to the client, right? But the key here is that because it's arbitrary, there's no standardization in the protocol, is that the particular server is just going to expect that byte stream to be in a certain format. And if the client doesn't send it in that format, it's not going to know what to do with it at all. So there has to be that kind of coordination, but there's no standard, right? So how, you know, there could be multiple competing standards. In other words, is what could proliferate. So like for instance, Dremio, you know, if you send an Arrow Flight buffer, really a byte stream of Arrow Flight buffers, to Dremio, we'll interpret that as UTF-8 encoded query string in SQL, and we'll execute that query. But you didn't necessarily know that as the client. And if you were to use, you know, saying that same byte stream to a different database, they might interpret it differently. You might not get your result. And really the key here is that Flight really is really designed to serve any tabular data, right? That was really the goal, not particularly databases. That wasn't the ultimate goal of Flight in the design. So like for instance, catalog information, right? Like what tables do I have, right? It's a simple one. It's not really part of Arrow Flight's design. But if we kind of take a step back, and again, in computing, there are very few like completely 100% net new problems, right? A lot of times it's the same problems or 80, 90% of the same problems, but in a new, you know, new incarnation, whether it's implementation or for whatever reason. And so if you look, well, ODBC and JDBC solve a very similar problem. Right, and they really standardize the query execution and catalog access, as well as some other calls for each database. Right, so well, okay, cool. Like, let's steal that solution. Right, as usually is the case, this is best. So that's really where Arrow Flight SQL comes in, is providing that standardization, where it's not just an arbitrary byte stream, where you start providing these things on top of it to really enable like database access and OLAP workloads. So let's go through what Arrow Flight SQL is. Really, it allows databases to use Arrow Flight as the transport protocol. So you leverage the, you know, performance of Arrow Flight and database access, but you also, on top of that, get the, you know, the nice things that you wanted, like what are my tables, right? That you want to standardize those messages. So you get these extended set of, you know, RPC calls. So a few examples here, like, you know, for query execution, this is what a query looks like, right? And this is the result set that gets sent back, right? Like as an example there, you know, prepared statements. Right, like okay, here's this query, but here's placeholders for the parameters. Right, don't execute it yet. I'll send you the parameters later, and then don't you have to go through the whole planning process for every single time I ask you to do that? You know, certainly around database catalog metadata for retrieving types, as well as, you know, what SQL abilities do you actually support? Right, because every database is slightly different as far as their SQL coverage. You know, the additional things that they add on top of ANSI SQL, et cetera. And it's also a single set of client libraries to connect to any Flight SQL server. So that's really big, is that regardless of what the database is, if it exposes the Flight SQL endpoints and it follows these standards, well, then you can connect using these client libraries. So you no longer have many-to-many or one-to-many. You actually have one-to-one, right, for any database and any client. So if we take a look at an example, just a quick one here, the client, you know, just says, you know, give me the list of tables. Right. So you'll see all of the bold, like the, for instance, 1 through 4 here, all of the non-bold text is actually Arrow Flight. So we're not replacing Arrow Flight. We're actually leveraging what Arrow Flight already provides us and then just building on top of it, extending. So you can see that the operations in bold, or the words in bold, I guess, are actually additional, like basically structures that say, hey, like they're basically standards, right? Like, hey, when I say this, this is what I mean. Right, so then the database knows what it's exactly getting, so it can list the tables and return that back. And then for querying a table, right, you send it in, this is exactly the SQL query, and this is what I expect, right? So you can standardize those. But again, it's still leveraging Arrow Flight under the cover, so you get the benefits there. So isn't that enough, right? Aren't we done yet? And the short answer is it would be nice. But reality is that, you know, Arrow Flight SQL is fairly new, and it's going to take time to be widely adopted by existing client tools, right? Especially if you look at the enterprise BI tools, right? Which the development pace is generally slower, the release cadence is slower, as well as their desire to adopt new things is also generally slower. But the nice thing is that, well, most BI tools, they already support ODBC and JDBC. Well, okay, can we, you know, give them something to make them work in the meantime while they, you know, work on adopting it natively? And that's really where Arrow Flight SQL, ODBC, and JDBC drivers come in. That's the problem that they set out to solve. So let's quickly look at, you know, let's look at these drivers and really what they are. So they're ODBC and JDBC drivers for the client, but they're built on top of Flight SQL libraries. So you can have this single, because you can have Flight SQL libraries, you can connect to any endpoint that exposes a Flight SQL server, or Flight SQL endpoints, sorry, this single driver now can connect to any of those, right? So if you just have a JDBC tool and you want to connect to, you know, any database that exposes Flight SQL, you can use this single driver. And you don't need to make any code changes, right? So you can pop this thing in Tableau, Power BI, you know, whatever your tool of choice is. And as long as your database exposes Flight SQL server, that's the only driver that you're going to need, which is pretty powerful. And the other key is that it's you know, completely open source. So we'll be fully open sourcing these very soon. And so the community can take full advantage of these and adopt them, as well as, you know, contribute back, provide feedback, contribute directly to them, you know, all of those kinds of things, which is pretty rare, you know, for ODBC and JDBC drivers. Those are almost always completely closed source for the most part, for as far as things are widely adopted. So let's take a quick comparison, right? Like, let's look at, you know, the traditional ODBC and JDBC versus the Arrow Flight SQL-based ODBC and JDBC drivers. And we look at it across two main axes of, you know, difference. First is driver management, and the second is performance. So with driver management, if we look at the traditional ODBC and JDBC, right, current state, you need to install and manage a driver for every single database, right? Each different database you're connecting to, you need to install and manage a driver for that. Versus Arrow Flight SQL, you just do that installation and you manage it, obviously, and you do that for a single driver, regardless of how many databases you're connecting to or connecting to a new database, right? When they all, you know, support Arrow Flight SQL. And then, so that's nice from one perspective, but if we really look at the performance as well, is that traditional ODBC, JDBC are all row-based transfers, right? So they're okay for small amounts of data, but they're really not great for large amounts of data. Versus Arrow Flight SQL-based ODBC and JDBC drivers, which are column-based transfer, right? So you really get that benefit of compression of the data over the wire. So you can benefit from that of, again, same thing with when you try to deal with bottlenecks, right? With like I/O compression, it allows you to transfer more logical data in fewer amount of bytes, right? So you get more data faster, effectively. So that all sounds great, right? So sounds like I should use ODBC and JDBC drivers for Arrow Flight SQL for everything, right? The answer to that is largely no, not everything. So when wouldn't I? And that's really when the key here is that it's generally preferable to actually have native Flight SQL applications. And that's really because one is that it's easier to harness, you know, future features where we'll actually expose where a single client can actually reach out to multiple worker endpoints for the database and actually pull that down in parallel, right? So that can improve throughput even well. But like things like that in the future that are coming, you can adopt that very easily if you use the native ones. And really the also key is that you get a lot better performance if your client is actually column-based as well. If you look at like your client's row-based, right? You need your database is columnar on the right, your client's row-based on the left, you're gonna need to convert it to row-based at some point. But you can leverage the, you know, columnar benefits when you actually transfer it over to the wire that we talked about, and then just convert it once you get it to the client. So if your client's row-based, this can make a lot of sense, right? Use the ODBC JDBC driver, and that's what happens, right? But if your client's column-based, well, you end up with columnar on the right in the database, columnar on the left in the client. Well, then if you can transfer the wire in column-based in Arrow format, which is great, but then you convert it to row-based with the ODBC JDBC driver, and then you need to convert it back to column-based. right? Which is unnecessary. So that's really, in this case, is really where you want to leverage the native Flight SQL endpoints, because then you get all the benefits of Arrow Flight SQL that we talked about in Arrow Flight, but without having to do this extra conversion. It's also the other really key is that for like existing tools, right, that we talked about there, that make it easy to adopt these benefits. And it's really on that point, if we kind of look at the stack, and I actually stole this great diagram from James Duong and David Lee's presentation here as well, that really, if we look at kind of the stack here, focusing on let's look at Arrow Flight SQL here, you can have the native client, right, which really goes right against Arrow Flight SQL, but you would still have your kind of legacy clients, or also, you know, your row-based clients, you may choose to do that as well, on top of JDBC, which then sits on top of Arrow Flight SQL, right? So you can still get all the benefits if you go native, and most of the benefits, depending on the situation, for JDBC. But generally, if you can go native libraries with Arrow Flight SQL, that's generally going to be preferable. So that was, you know, all I wanted to go through here. So, you know, certainly thanks for watching. And if you have any, you know, questions or comments on the presentation, feel free to reach out to me, jason@dremio.com, with any feedback or questions or comments that you might have. So thanks for watching, everybody.